There can be no doubt that the White Cliffs of Dover are one of the country's most spectacular natural features. On top of the cliffs lies more than 2,000 years of history. Dover Castle, the medieval keep, casting a shadow over Dover, to the maze of tunnels and passages beneath it. To the north of Dover Castle, we have been looking into the history of Fort Burgoyne, an 1860 fortress built to protect Dover Castle. We are joined with Andrew Morgan, who's taken us on a journey through history. Let's continue that journey, folks. Let's go.
So, what do you see here? You see the original Victorian wall for infantry, or your gunners, your artillerymen with little carbines to fire over the top. You can see some 1940 metalwork put in there to support barbed wire to thicken it up. But you see a World War II pillbox. But is there anything special about it that you see?
Front concrete, isn't it?
Well, yes, it's multi-sided in brick. It's on a concrete platform, which is learning from First World War experience of undermining of pillboxes. And as you say, it's massively reinforced on a lightly attacker side in concrete. But if you look at that more closely, by World War II, everybody knew you needed camouflage. So they built it, but they've actually cast into the concrete the tree that was here. So here's the trunk, there's branches going off.
Oh wow.
You had overhead camouflage, natural. You didn't need to renew it, it would renew itself.
That is crazy.
There's a little one the other side as well.
That's crazy.
They obviously didn't take into account that the tree grows. That's the only thing, like at the top there.
Yes.
Blown the corner off.
I suppose it, after the war, you know, just pull it down.
It was only going to be temporary, wasn't it, I suppose?
Yeah. Madness.
There's some consideration, it might have been the base for some generating equipment.
Oh, okay.
Because obviously if you've got anti-aircraft guns, you need searchlights.
Yeah.
Is it all hollow, so?
No. There's nothing underneath it.
No, but look at that. That's weird, isn't it?
Yeah, sure. It's a long shaft. But
mystery.
Mystery indeed.
Bulbs on. That original gate.
I like the gates.
All right.
Okay. Are you okay?
Yep.
Okay, so imagine this wall doesn't exist. This is a ramp going from the level you are at the gate up to the parade ramp. So that is the original surface there, just inside this ornamented gate. And at the bottom of the ramps, in each case, the three ramps, you have this much more ornamental, much more solid gate. Ornamental, and you've got spearheads at the top. You've got interlocking things here, but they're very much stronger than the plain round metal gates.
Alright.
So here again, you have a little tax, sort of room, instant storeroom office. And again on this side, mind the ground, you have soak away drains and things, a lot of which are full of mud and stuff. So in one hand, you have these beautiful gates. And inside you can see the wooden structure, like I said, a wooden doorway to control the draft in and out of the caponier. And then, you know, in spite of the beautiful vaulted brickwork, and that's worth a close look at when you get to angles and alteration in height, and then they casually throw a water pipe across the middle of it.
Oh yeah. See that spike on the end of that? Wow, it looks like an arrowhead.
Exactly. And the most ornamental gates are these, are the beginning of the slopes down to the Capenir.
They've lost all the spikes, haven't they?
Yep.
Oh, they've all been cut?
Yeah.
Somebody fancied them for their own garden gate, I
think. Wow.
The point is that this is a typical, yeah, just mind how slippery and some of them there, odd bricks missing and all that kind of. Just, you know, you can see where the hinges were on both sides, so that it was a double doorway here. Not intended to stop rifle fire or anything, but to control light and air. There's quite a draft through that.
Yes.
Okay, mind your footing at all. There are odd lighting chambers and things like this in here.
Well, see that.
Because there are similar ones elsewhere in the fort that we know were gas, because you can see the light fittings they go to.
Yeah.
Equally, whenever anything is attached to the brickwork, there's no drills and roll plugs. Think you just don't, you either knock out a bit of brick or cut a brick short, put a block of wood in, and then you nail into that. There's no sort of drilling into individual bricks. Plus there are lots of square bits. On electrical wiring.
The blue paint again on the ceiling.
Yeah. You can see light chambers, air chambers, and equally here we can see into the top of the steps here. You can see the stonework. And in this case, the brickwork that's built, there'll be a timber along that brickwork and then the cross member above, which is why this timber bulk seems to be sitting in midair. There should be a runner of timber all along the brickwork.
Right.
And all that helps absorb shock, whether it's for the guns you're firing or any explosions landing on the outside of the structure.
Is that a magazine in there, is it?
That's a boot scraper.
Yep, little boot scraper.
That's nice.
Well, similar to them in a tunnel before.
So these are expense magazines. You have places for the racking. You have, again, the brickwork in place. So you'd have the upper floor above, identical, and you know it's a magazine because you have this ventilation tunnel around the outside of it.
Yeah. Never seen one on top of each other before.
Not that.
Popeye there behind you. Graffiti.
That is Popeye.
I don't know how old that is.
Yep. We have Popeye elsewhere. Also, you have Don R, which is a motorbike rider.
Oh, right.
DR, dispatch rider. Don was phonetic alphabet during a period of time. Like Abel, Baker, Charlie, Don, or Dog, depends.
Yeah.
Nowadays you have Delta. Delta Romeo would be it. But you have the wheel, flying wheel, indicating high-speed motorcyclists delivering messages.
So that's sort of original.
Yep, original graffiti in short. Equally, before you go away, let's see the ventilation bricks in here. You have a lighting chamber here, nice deep. You'd have glass that glazed to keep the flame of your lantern away from explosive.
Right.
And you have more ventilators down here. You actually have parts of the archway here,
yeah,
of the doorway, the door frame here.
The other bits
and
precariously
here,
balanced above your head.
Yep, that's above.
Yep, that's wow.
I did look at that before I came in. The point is here, you have where the original woodwork half door was, so you could serve or hand out the ammunition from there. And again, you have, you know, part of the framework here.
That back tree we went to.
Sheerness.
Yeah, that's got that little thing. I never really realised.
Yeah, it's intact.
It's for sale, yeah.
It's a hatch. It's to stop people coming in. But you can have it to serve.
That's cool, yeah.
So that explains why that bulk of timber is in there. Because there's timber missing underneath it.
Okay. That's a big thing.
To the end first.
Right.
You can see the whole structure is vaulted and connected with massive girders. Immensely strong, but by having timber inserts as well, you're also adding a little bit of a shock absorber to it. And above you can see the brackets here for the gunner's equipment, i.e. ramrods, sponges, etc. for the carronades. Now, as time went on, it became obvious that muzzle-loading carronades, sawn-off shotgun artillery were less effective than a machine gun, for example. But things changed. So what you see from the outside, these are the rifle positions. Here are the rings for putting block and tackle to pull the gun around. And here is the port blocked up that you would actually fire out of. Now, originally, this plate, and I'm sure we can find you another one, sat horizontally, a handle on each side here, on little runners, the grooved runners here, and you could just wheel it to one side. So you'd pull the plate to one side, put your carronade muzzle through there, and fire. When it's fired, you shut that. Again, it's controlling airflow. If it's at night, you're stopping incoming fire, you're stopping light going out, you're making yourself much less obvious.
One at the top has still got
the wheels. And it's duplicated at the top, yeah. That's still in place. We have got some where the wheels are much better as well. Now, if you look at the roof, you can see there's the chimney. Right. And there's the ring for mounting the guns. Now, because the ramp comes down to the lower level here, to get the guns up to there, you have the wooden floor above us, okay? But you need a trap door in it to lift your guns up and down. For the carronades being quite short, it's not so difficult. On the wall here, you can see the remains of rusted brackets. There were these for trimlets, lanterns. There were a specific lantern of a naval design originally, where you could reduce the beam to a slot, vertical slot, or a wide beam, because sometimes you need a lot of light and sometimes you really want to reduce the light you're showing, such as when you open the firing port. Now in this case, you've actually got a concrete base. Some of them are plain chalk. The ones above would have been timber. Nothing on the timber. There is a false rumour or myth that there was a layer of slate laid on it. There's no reason for that. Slate is very heavy and it's a linear stone, so that the last thing you want is to be whacking it, because that's how you break it into smaller sections, by applying shock to it in specific areas. And to have even a small cannon crashing on it, not a good thing. So considering the carronade was designed specifically for wooden warships, Why would you need anything on top of it apart from the wood? Carronade looks like this. So quite a short barrel, large bore. This is quite a late one, you can tell by the breech mechanism here, although it's muzzle loading. And it's on a block mounting, i.e. it has two wheels of iron at the front, but it just has a block, a wooden block at the back. And the friction of this recoiling backwards, running on timber, as it is here in a fort made of stone, proves the point, is that it's the friction between wood and wood that helps control the recoil. Because the whole thing is going to run back a lot when you fire that. The ones in the Caponiers usually were 24 pounders. That's about 5.5 inch caliber or so. And what you'd usually load that with is canister, which is like a tin can, because can is short for canister, which is the original term. So a tin canister full of musket balls, perhaps 3/4 inch caliber, approximately 0.79, which is 12 ball. And then as that fires, as the canister leaves the muzzle, it tends to split apart, but it keeps the lot easy to load, very quick to load indeed. But you can see rings here, so you can put block and tackle to pull it back into position. And what you'll find in some of these positions up against the brickwork here, where you can see where in this case it's absent, but you can see the stain that's left on the brickwork, you have a block of wood called the bumper where the iron wheels rest. So you know when it goes thunk, the iron wheel hits that woodwork, but the gun is fully in position.
Right.
And it means that the iron wheel doesn't get whacked into the brickwork, damaging it over a period of time. Here's the sally port. You can see the wheels on the top there for the cables controlling the drawbridge. It's all long been bricked up, but it's same as at the main gate, effectively. Channels here, as by the main gate, for the counterbalance weights for the drawbridge. But you can see the wheels and the tie downs. Here. Equally firing positions above.
Just makes you wonder what it looks like down in the Western Outworks. Mm-hmm. Under Dover. Mm-hmm. The Western Heights. Mm-hmm. Pretty similar, isn't it?
Yep. There's lots more because it's a weak point, it's a point of access deliberately built in, you've got many more firing points.
Yeah.
Or right on. Chimney. Yeah. What's interesting is you can make out here, above this girder, you can make out originally where they were iron gates.
Yeah.
You see the marks on the brickwork there? As I said, the whole thing is about keeping it compartmentalised so you can control each bit if it's overrun. Oh. Mind where you go with the camera.
Yeah, I fell down one of them before.
Should be this one as well. Originally, you would have had fireplaces in here. You can see the chimneys going up and up here, and the ventilator brick above. And the idea of that is it also ties in further above. The idea is to create a draft to disperse the smoke inside. Also, the gunners get benefit of a small bit of heat, but also it means you can use an instant match lit from that to fire the cannon, rather than any more advanced firing mechanism. This is standard throughout all the Caponiers.
Right.
So you've got the fireplace there. Put a ventilator above, and then there's a chimney. Just inside.
This is the one that's got the door in place.
Exactly, and you can see the wheels.
Oh yeah. Here.
And the rifle positions on each side. The beauty of it is, it's so detailed, bear in mind that we were never encouraged to shoot left-handed any time. So if you want to shoot someone just outside, you've got this cutaway so you can get your shoulder right in here.
Alright.
Yeah. Every little detail.
It's more pronounced in some of the, on the flank of Caponiers.
Yeah.
It's much more obvious than that, and much more curved. If you look at the vaulting, absolutely beautifully done.
Yeah. Never get brick like that, work like that again, I'd say.
Well,
never.
You would, but it's not really true.
That's true.
Yeah. Don't go down the house, don't know what's stopped it.
Is that part of the original slab that would have went over it?
It looks like a recessed slab that sits in there, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, never seen exactly. That before. It's all been sort of broken out.
Yeah. Well, that's. But that's what they are, the counterbalance.
So it's been patched over the years in the corner.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All that is all fireplaces, etc. This one's actually got angles, and there you've got the grate in that one.
Oh yeah.
Well, that and oddly, you've got a bit of sword of Damocles corrugated on.
It doesn't look very safe.
So no, it doesn't. Looks like, well, there's the iron support there for the base of the fire. So it looks like there was a problem with that one.
Yeah.
And it's just being blocked off at some time because that looks like the corrugated iron's been attached there. So that looks like hinges. But it's odd that this one comes in at such an angle.
Mm. It's a shame none of the floors survived. It must have been stripped out at some point, wasn't it, on the floors?
Yes. Yeah.
Would you reckon keep warm or something like that? Burn it.
Burn the floor.
I don't know. Cold nights, 1940.
You're right. The thing is with this is the temperature stays pretty much static, but the dampness stays the same as well. So unless you introduce some heat constantly, it's going to be quite nasty to your health over a period of time.
Yeah.
With concrete shelters, you get bentonitis, which is an inflammation of the lungs due to the concrete breaking down chemically, in fact. These things like Maginot line, they have a problem with that. But you get the same thing from chalk. Because it holds the damp. I mean, the whole thing is damp, isn't it?
Mm.
So, very bad for you.
And it's
your chest.
Yeah.
Daytime. Oh, look at the writing on that piece of wood. It's upside down, but.
Yes.
What's it saying?
Where you are. Your.
Weird, isn't it?
Mm.
Hold the camera the other way up and then
you'll... Yeah. Oh, yeah. The screen is...
You can turn it around.
Right, so these are gun rooms next to... down there.
Yeah.
Side ones.
Do we go now? Can do, yeah.
Should we go?
Go through one here.
Cave spiders.
No, look. More firing positions.
So here you're firing directly outside the extruding part of the Caponier. So this is the inner wall of the ditch, if you like. We're in the inner wall of the ditch and that is it. But they pretty soon block those up because you don't want to leave any more opportunities to drop something nasty up against it, in it. So these are the same with the ventilation bricks above. And you can see that's daylight directly from this.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's just in the wing Caponiers, or flank Caponiers. There's years worth of graffiti to explore. So that bit's bricked. This bit's not, but it just shows how the brickwork ties in. And of course, we go back far enough, tens of thousands of years, these levels of flint and chalk go back under the channel. And at one time there would have been a land bridge which connected Europe to us directly. Just eventually that crumbled and was washed away.
That's another void there.
Well, no, what you've got, because bear in mind that the main cabin is here, you may need to pick someone up right off the outside wall. Get your shoulder right in there.
Yeah.
And from this position, you'd be firing straight out along the front of the cabin. Yeah. You don't need that sort of angle.
Right.
Yeah.
Camera angle. You see the natural light coming in when that slope went right up the parade ground, you would have had much more light as well.
Yeah.
You're just getting a vertical light into that shaft now.
Yeah. That's concrete there.
Oh yeah.
Chalk again, yeah.
Any graffiti?
Oh, there is there, look.
Some bits, yeah. It's
kind of hard. 1933.
Come here.
1933.
Nice horseshoe there. Below you there.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
96.
Yeah.
96. 33.
You all right, Chris?
Yeah.
Let's just quickly have a look up here. Won't fall off. Shows the height.
The thing is, under those, you can stack barrels of water,
yeah,
whatever you want, anything like that, and they're well protected. That's the ventilation. We'll look at some rooms, shall we? Ground level?
Yep. Oh,
Oh yeah.
I see the sort of door.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah.
This is one.
Nice blanket. What's that?
Water tank.
Oh yeah.
There's the pump.
Like,
off the sink.
Yeah.
Like an ROC one.
What we have in here is access to one of the water systems. So you have a hand pump here. Rotary hand pump. Pump water up.
How big is that down there then?
Yeah, you go into the water storage.
Quite a big one.
Yeah.
Mm.
Big.
Yeah.
But you see some of the good bits. You can see the original light fitting. Start off there. You can see the chimney alongside it. You can see how much is intact in the internal glassware.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. The serving hatch here. The fact that it's been a storeroom, always, you know, been used a long time as a storeroom because of the iron bars on here. Equally, you can see ventilation bricks here, up and down. You can see the remains on there of what would have been an enameled lampshade. And then the subtlety of the water system. I just chuck a pipe through the whole thing. And with the other hand, you know, you've got the original timber work here, door frames, etc. But this is extremely solid, much more solid than some of the others, which are more like that kind of
right.
type framework. You can see some of the racking that would have been in this room. And then you have some numbers that relate to slip.
What's that from the old days?
Well, it isn't from tomorrow.
Oh. That's penciled in as well, yeah.
Countings, I suppose, isn't it?
But you can see, from like I said, from the corridor, all you can see is a standard doorway from the outside.
Yeah.
So as an intruder, you wouldn't know whether it was an important one or what it was at all. But equally, it stops pilfering or deliberate theft, more serious nature. But the bars are on everything. So this is a non-standard room, if you like.
So if you look, the shape of the door.
If you look, it's had a bar, bar and padlock reinforce on that, beyond the normal latch and lock. These doors are meant to be part of the defence.
Lovely flooring still in place.
Mm-hmm. That's it, hard polish.
Oh wow.
So
I'm not sure, but it does say 7:55 down there.
55?
Although this is a not it's a lathe, it's a metal working lathe. Although this is a non-standard room, you have a standard fireplace. You would have had an iron stove here, coal burning. And you can see that goes up to the chimney here.
We'll shut that door in a minute. Right.
We have a fire here.
Fire?
Mm-hmm. A cold stove. Oh, look at that.
And the look, rags.
Well, I think because of the fire hazard, you've got the disturbed and tying it there, which is non-standard. This is more modern, this is not the very first one, but similar. Equally, if you look here, bear in mind that during the day, during the night, you would have had super long iron bedsteads that folded up. So you end up with one sort of 3 foot by 3 foot square, or 3 foot by 2 foot, which everything's piled. Bed folds up, and then you still have one long mattress, you have three biscuits, as they're called, because they look like a biscuit. Three sections of the mattress that you lay down. That's what you start with the straw, and the pillows, etc., etc. So your iron bedstead, during the day, that gets folded up, and you have trestle tables, which at night, folded up against the wall, trestle tables and trestle benches in the middle, underneath the lights. You can see two ventilators there. But equally, there's some original piece of ironwork here for light fittings in the centre. But to protect the brickwork, I said about the pump and a bit of wood to stop it. Carronade with wagging. You've got something to stop the feet of the bed of iron whacking the wall. You have this to stop the head of the bed whacking against the wall. And then above that you have, and these are cast iron, in sections that link together, a standard Victorian, so these are original equipment racks. So on this you'd have a shelf on the top like this, on which you'd have your backpack, your shaker, your cap, etc. And then your leather equipment, so your ammunition pouch is bayoneted, would hang down in a prescribed order. So everything can be easily inspected. We have various bits in various rooms. So this is complete and it's got those bits. It's complete, it's got that. On here, in some of the other rooms, there was a double door wooden cupboard, so we could reproduce that. This one looks as if it might have been part of the schoolroom at some time, or some education room. But they do vary, so the use changes over the years. It's been, you know, active for so long, but it would have seen a lot of different applications. But the fittings, those fittings are standard to the Victorian bathroom. It's just the style of their missing.
Yeah, I've seen them before. It's South Casement, it's North Casement.
Yeah. What's the point? The point is, with these, you're putting blocks in the wall, into woods, and block these keys, not. So you wipe them off, turn that key a bit to hold it in position. And then this is one casting, and you just fit as many as you want. So in a way, you're using millions of bricks, but you're buying them from all over the UK and transporting them to your site, so you're not encouraging local brick manufacturers to put the price up because they think they've got a monopoly because you're alongside it. It might be cheaper to bring them to the north of England, for example, and ship them into Dover Port. But you're standardising all kinds of equipment, like on these racks. I had two chimneys up top, haven't you? You've got little ones, the taller ones. Right, so the little ones are from the back rooms, and the taller ones are from this corridor that runs at the back. The point is that if you look at these doors, these are meant to be defended as well, so quite substantial. Some of them have got hooks you can bar them. So everything was meant to be defended and isolated. So your men can rush up here, they rush down to, usually at the end of each corridor, at someplace there is a storage area for ammunition, a magazine. So, because they have their weapons with them, but they need to collect ammunition, and that you can issue as required, you can control that. There's a lot of racking in that one, but a lot of it's not as old as one, I think.
Cool smell. It smells a lot, right?
Just looking at that, look at that. Ian, do you know what that is, do you? No, it's got a... Hang on.
What is it?
It's one of them.
Right. What was, do you know what this was in for? It's got some sort of stretcher or something.
I wonder that, it seems a long
one. Long, isn't it?
It's a bit of a flagpole, isn't it?
Oh. Is it?
Well, look, it's kind of...
Mountain. On that end as well.
Looks like an upper section of flagpole.
No light.
Yeah, exactly, with the chain. And the point is, the fort is built in an arc. Okay, the ramparts and thus the casemate rooms are built in an arc. So you have bits where you have square rooms or rectangular rooms, so you need to fill in a bit. And those are storage areas, and they have ventilation bricks facing into the parade ground and racking like this.
You look at the ceiling where all the angles meet.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Leave kit.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
So these are people's personal effects, aren't they, that have been stored for some reason?
You're breaching the wall there.
Yeah. Yeah, she's had abuse.
Yeah. Still standing strong though.
Absolutely.
Very good. Done. Really?
I don't know if it's old or not.
So this corridor nominally ran the whole length. There are an occasional shower blocks at the back of a washroom. There's asbestos it takes, so we don't encourage access to any of that. But originally, it's the quickest protected access to every room.
Right.
But over the years, various bits have been blocked off to increase its defensive possibilities.
Yeah, it looks impressive, that corridor, doesn't it? The light coming in.
Yep. Looks like a dead mouse to me.
Yeah. Yep.
Something interesting in it.
Right.
We just go behind us. We'll go just beyond the main archway there.
Join us next week when we continue exploring this fascinating fortification. See you then, folks.